Today on Christian World News, U.S. President Barack Obama visits Africa, including Tanzania, where churches are under attack from a growing Islamist threat. Plus, the U.S. Supreme Court opens the door for gay marriage in America. We'll take a look at the fallout and where we go from here. And meet the woman who's standing up to Iran's mullahs. Naghme Abedini tells us about the fight to free her husband from a Tehran jail. And welcome, everyone, to Christian World News. I'm Wendy Griffith. George Thomas is on vacation. U.S. President Barack Obama is reaching out to Africans this week, touring Senegal and South Africa, as well as Tanzania, where he's meeting with President Kikwete and the nation's business leaders. The country's Christians are hoping Mr. Obama will speak out against increased acts of persecution against them. Gary Lane brings us this look at some recent incidents.
The allure of beautiful beaches and tranquil ocean waters draw 100,000 tourists to the island of Zanzibar each year. Visitors and their money are welcome to the Tanzanian paradise. But this East African island, influenced by Islamic extremism, has a dark past and a troubling present.
This is a slave memorial here in Zanzibar. Several hundred years ago, when Arab traders first came to this island, they were quick to enslave the local population. Fast forward to 2013, they're no longer slaves here, but today Christians are suffering.
Churches have been attacked and Christian leaders threatened. Last February, a Catholic priest was killed outside this church.
I heard a crowd of people chanting Allahu Akbar, Takbir, destroy this church of, infidel.
In May 2012, Bishop Dixon Kaganga helped church members flee a Saturday evening prayer meeting as an angry mob approached. He remained behind in a church office.
They were saying that, this pastor, all the Saturday he used to come here, maybe he's here, look after him, where he is, They were saying, we don't want this church here, we don't want Christianity in Zanzibar.
The Muslim extremists never found Bishop Dixon, but they destroyed his car and set fire to chairs and church equipment inside the building.
They opposed the church. They opposed the message of Christ. When you preach Christ and Jesus is doing signs and wonders, and Muslims are convinced, to become to Christianity. So they want to attack this. They don't want this,
And it's not only happening in Zanzibar. Church attacks have also spread to the Tanzanian mainland, like this one that killed three people and injured at least a dozen others in the town of Arusha last May. Author Raymond Ibrahim says extremists are now waging jihad in African countries that have a high percentage of Christians.
It's resurgent Islamic mentality, which is just, it's everywhere. And now in Tanzania, of course, which earlier you never thought of as being a radical nation.
Church leaders say attacks and threats have actually strengthened the Tanzanian body of Christ. As for Bishop Dixon's church, services resumed after repairs were made. He encourages Zanzibarian Christians to remain focused on God.
He is faithful in us that we will endure and we will pass through this and we will become victorious. And many good things are happening. But I don't want people to cry. Let's rejoice.
Gary Lane, CBN News, Zanzibar.
Thanks, Gary. Opponents of Egyptian President Mohamed Morsi are rejecting his call for dialogue and national reconciliation. In a speech on national TV, Morsi admitted he's made mistakes and promised to give political opponents and minorities more say in governing. But critics say it's too little, too late, and they're calling for early elections. They charge that Morsi has empowered radical Islamists, pushed through unpopular constitutional amendments, and tried to grab more power. Widespread protests are expected this weekend on the first anniversary of Morsi's presidency. And joining us now from our Washington, D.C. bureau is Magdi Khalil of Coptic Solidarity. President Morsi says he needs more time to institute real change in Egypt. What do you think?
Really, it is not the matter of time. It's a matter of direction. He went to the wrong direction. He promised, he elected 1 year ago, and he promised that he will be the president of all Egyptians. But President Morsi has used every opportunity to turn Egypt into an Islamic and Islamist state. Mm. So he doesn't believe in Egyptian nation. He believes in Islamic caliphate. So why he only take care of his people, Muslim Brotherhood group. So it's not the matter of time. It's a matter of direction. He went to the wrong direction, to the Islamic State.
So you think his actions definitely don't match his words then?
Sure, sure. He said many things and, sorry, many lies. Many lies, because he promised to take care of all Egyptians, to be the president of all Egyptians, including Coptic Christians. But in his era, 1 year, 20 churches, partially or completely burned or attacked, and only one permit to rebuild the church, one permit only. So Morsi is a president of Muslim Brotherhood group only, not for all Egyptians.
Are you saying that things are a lot worse now for Christians under Morsi than they were under Mubarak?
Sure, sure. From 19 February 11, 2011 to till now, a lot of attacks against Copts in Egypt, churches, properties, hijacked, kidnapping girls, killed the Copts everywhere. A lot of troubles under Muslim Brotherhood era in Islamic way, that the rule of Muslim Brotherhood, we expect more and more under Islamic rule. This is the Islamic rule to discriminate and persecute non-Muslims.
Well, do you think that the demonstrations that are planned on his one-year anniversary will turn violent, and how will the military respond?
I think, sure. Also, it's a matter of time that Egypt will go to a civil war, because Muslim Brotherhood and other Islamists only believe in power and violence. So they don't keep silent. They don't believe in peaceful demonstrations. So they will attack the peaceful demonstrations, Tahrir and all squares in Egypt. Egypt in really crisis. Really divided into two groups, two rival groups like Muslim Brotherhood and Islamists in the inside, and the other Egyptians the other side. So the rest of Egyptians the other side. Muslim Brotherhood present less than 1% of Egyptians, but 99% on the other side against the Muslim Brotherhood and against the Morsi rules.
All right. Magdi Khalil, we appreciate so much your insights. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
In other news, human rights leaders called on the U.S. government to do more to protect Syria's minority Christian community. Speaking before Congress, the Hudson Institute's Nina Shea suggested the 2,000-year-old Christian community is under threat of extinction.
Christians are the targets of an ethno-religious cleansing by Islamist militants and their Sharia courts. In addition, they have lost the protection of the Assad government, making them easy prey for criminals and fighters whose affiliations are not always clear.
Shea detailed recent kidnappings and murders of Christians and their church leaders. She also criticized a recent U.S. State Department report for its, quote, gross understatement that Syrian Christians are only facing harassment and intolerance. Muslim radicals in Nigeria have murdered a Christian pastor. The Reverend Jacob Kwiza was retired from the Church of Christ in Nigeria. Last week, Islamists hunted him down near Maiduguri. The Muslims ordered the pastor to renounce his Christian faith and convert to Islam. When he refused, they slashed his throat. Islamic extremists also torched at least four churches in that area. Coming up, the U.S. Supreme Court issues two rulings on gay marriage. Our look at what it means for this biblical institution in America.
From CBN, Oh, someone forgot to lock up.
Everyone deserves a second chance.
And you're sure it was Sharon?
Definitely, Principal Travis.
Maybe this time we can help her make another choice.
What's up?
I can't believe it. Sharon Meyer stole a bike in broad daylight, and Miss Travis just wants to let her slide by.
Superbook!
Log on to CBN.com and receive Superbook's newest episode, Jonah, for your gift of $25.
Nineveh. God wanted me to warn them he was about to pass judgment. I say no. If Nineveh is doomed, then let it be doomed.
Get him off his shirt!
Fish were slimy on the outside.
Give the children you love the Word of God as a foundation in their lives.
People of Nineveh!
It is amazing. Your words have been heard by all of Nineveh.
Superbook, Jonah, available now.
He healed the sick, walked on water, and rebuked the storm. Jesus performed miracles that changed the world, and he shared the secret to that power with you and me.
Gordon Robertson, in his latest DVD, Our Father, Keys to the Lord's Prayer, takes you on a journey from King David's palace to the Sea of Galilee, revealing the mystery and the meaning of the greatest prayer of all time. You'll discover a deeper relationship with God, what it means to overcome evil, how to pray in the power of the kingdom, and the life-changing purpose God has for you. As a special bonus, you'll see a tour of some of Israel's most important sites and learn the amazing discoveries that are being uncovered today.
Learn how to pray the way Jesus prayed and release the power of God's kingdom in your life.
Get Our Father, Keys to the Lord's Prayer, available now.
Here in the U.S., the nation's highest court this week issued two important rulings on gay marriage. While the court did not make same-sex marriage a fundamental right, it did make gay spouses eligible for federal benefits, and it cleared the way for gay marriage in the state of California. As Paul Strand reports, that means the battle over gay marriage in America is far from over.
Gay individuals and groups, as well as their lawyers who fought against DOMA and Proposition 8, now say the next step is to battle nationwide for legalized same-sex marriage everywhere.
We cannot forget our LGBT brothers and sisters that are in states that still discriminate against them, and we will not allow it.
Within 5 years, we will bring marriage equality to all 50 states in this vast country.
With marriage equality back in California, 40% of the population of the United States is covered by marriage equality.
The lawyers battling Proposition 8 say it's effectively dead because the justices ruled those defending it had no standing to defend it.
They said the proponents have no concrete injury. They cannot point to anything that harms them because these two loving couples and couples like them throughout California are now going to be able to get married.
Those on the other side weren't necessarily admitting defeat on Prop 8. They say at most the high court has thrown California and gay marriage into somewhat of a legal limbo.
We remain committed to the continued enforcement of Proposition 8 until there is a statewide order saying otherwise.
Even as it wiped DOMA out, the court specifically did not say states have to legalize gay marriage. But its two rulings are big boosts to the gay marriage momentum.
Supporters of traditional marriage certainly have a beef with what the Supreme Court has done here. They're saying, how can five justices decide these crucial questions about marriage when the voters and the legislators in 38 states have decided differently?
One of the biggest problems with gay marriage is that in most states where it's become legal, Christians who stand up too clearly for traditional marriage end up getting bashed, sometimes sued. Could that now happen nationwide with DOMA's defeat, especially with the way the justices denigrated opponents of gay marriage?
Now that the majority said that laws defining marriage between one man and one woman are not supported by any rational basis, that they are driven by either ignorance or hostility, I fear that we're going to see a flood of lawsuits where that'll be the lead for the plaintiffs right out at the gate.
Reverend Rob Shank says believers need to get ready.
The script has already been written. Christians are angry, mean, bigoted, narrow-minded, ugly people. That's the stereotype. I think we have to do what we can to defeat that stereotype.
All sides on this issue say what the court has done here is important, but it certainly does not decide the question of gay marriage for all of America. Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from the Supreme Court.
Up next, beat the woman whose husband made headlines when he was sentenced to 8 years in Iran's notorious Evin prison.
CBNNews.com. News you want, when you want, 24/7. Stay current with up-to-the-minute stories.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News, New York.
I don't have to wait for my news anymore.
CBNNews.com, at your fingertips all day long.
I only watch the stories I want to see.
I find the story, I click on it, and boom, I'm there.
Embassy in Washington, Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News.
The source for your news, CBNNews.com.
Come on, give me that. Bye. Sure, life is busy, but I found a way to make a huge difference in people's lives. I guess you could say I'm changing the world right here from home. I bring medical supplies and doctors to people in need and dig wells so that villagers can have clean and safe water to drink. I make it possible to preach the gospel in over 100 countries, including right here in America. And when disaster strikes, I'm there, providing food, thank you, and emergency supplies to give people hope again. Every day, CBN and I are making the world a better place. Here you go. My life is hectic, so I join CBN through Pledge Express. My bank does all the work, and I know that my gift is being used where it's needed most. So become a CBN partner and join Pledge Express, because you can do a world of good right from where you are. Hi, good morning. Are you ready to get started?
He healed the sick, walked on water, and rebuked the storm. Jesus performed miracles that changed the world, and he shared the secret to that power with us.
Learn how to release the power of God's kingdom here on earth.
Get Gordon Robertson's latest DVD teaching, Our Father, Keys to the Lord's Prayer, available now.
1 year ago, Nagme Abedini said goodbye to her husband, Saeed, as he set off on a trip. She never dreamed that 12 months later, she'd be in the middle of a fight for his freedom and his life. Recently, I spoke with Nagme about her battle with the government of Iran on CBN 700 Club. But first, here's a look at what she and her family have been through in the past year.
Nagme Abedini is living a nightmare. Last July, her husband, American pastor Saeed Abedini, was in Iran to help establish an orphanage when he was arrested by Iranian authorities. Then, in January, he was sentenced to 8 years in Iran's infamous Evin prison. His crime? Preaching the gospel. Saeed has endured physical and psychological abuse and has been denied medical treatment. Nagme says at times, the strain over the past 12 months has seemed unbearable for her and her two young children. The American Center for Law and Justice has been fighting for Saeed's freedom. Nagme believes that through prayer, it will be God, not the government, who will free her husband.
Tell us the latest on your husband. Has anybody seen him, and how is he holding up?
Mm-hmm. His family gets to see him every week, so they saw him this week and he was doing okay. He's still, he's had some beatings and so he still has issues with his internal bleeding. He's much better, but there's still pains and we're still hoping to get him treated. Sure. Still needs medical attention.
Well, Iran has a new president, President Rouhani. Is this good news at all for your husband or will it factor in at all?
You know, he at the same day he was elected, there was Christian sentenced to a few years in prison. Above Rouhani is the supreme leader, Khamenei, who really controls everything. And his mindset, his policy towards Christianity has always been the same, that they see it as a national threat, security to their national, threat to their national security. And I don't see much of a change. I hope they try to present, try to bring more freedom for the Christians and release Saeed, but...
But right now, you don't think it'll make much of a difference?
I don't think it's going to make much of a difference. Mm-hmm.
Nagme, you were born in Iran to Muslim parents, mm-hmm. Grew up Muslim. How did you become a Christian?
God's grace. I was always seeking him. I grew up right when I was very young in Iran, and there was a war, and there was bombs, and people were dying around me. There was a war with Iran and Iraq, and I always, that made me think about who is God, where is he? And I tried to find him through Islam and at the young age, 8 or 9. And when I came to the States, my brother had a vision of Christ, and he said, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life." And my
and you were young, right?
We were 8 or 9, mm-hmm. and my and Jesus said, you know, and he felt such a strong love. And when he saw that vision, he came to me and he told me, and he was a changed person. And so,
so you got saved based on your brother's dream about Jesus.
But it was so, we're twins, so we're so close. Mm. So I just saw, he was so shaken. And so I accepted Christ at that age.
Talk about childlike faith.
Yeah, and it's been, you know, it's been an amazing journey.
Nagmeh, what was he doing, exactly what was he doing when he was arrested last summer?
He was working on an orphanage that a government approved. He was working with the government to start. We'd started on the orphanage since 2009, and the kids and I had gone back with them in 2011 and stayed for a few months hoping the orphanage would be open.
He was there under government approval.
Yes, they had approved it. He was working with them.
Yeah. Now, you have two young children. How are they coping? I know they must be missing their dad terribly.
Oh, it's been hard. Recently I shared a video on my Facebook that shows Jacob crying, saying, "Jesus, I love you, bring daddy home." Mm. And he's just in tears. And they sent out balloons and messages to Jesus saying, "Bring him home." And you know, like childlike faith, they prayed, and then they wake up, and sometimes they had a dream, and they look around and they say, "Is daddy home yet?" And I say, "No, we just gotta wait." I try to speak to them from the Bible about patience. And
but you believe he will come home?
I do. I've had to, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, I've had to say, I believe God's gonna deliver, but even if he doesn't, he's still a good God. And I've had to really lay it at the altar. I've learned to not control situations or push God for a certain outcome, and just to let go and say, "God, you know, you are a good God. You've been so gracious and kind to us during this time. And whatever the outcome, I do hope he's going to come home, but whatever the outcome, God's still God."
And you have been so strong for your kids, but you've just been strong in general. You've been on every TV show. You've been in front of Congress. You've been to the UN, working tirelessly to educate people and to let them know what's happening to your husband. How do you do that? Where do you get the strength?
From Christ. I was a crumbling mess, and I found the connection to the vine. And the Bible says, you know, when we find that connection, the fruit comes. And I have to say, one of the highlights, it's been a year since I physically held my husband and said goodbye. We said on June 22nd of 2012, I said a quick goodbye. I said, "See you in a few weeks," you know, never thinking. But I look at the year, speaking before the UN, I got to share about Christ. I got to say, Christ, Said is in prison because he believes Jesus Christ died for the sin of humanity, and whoever believes in him can be reconciled to God. I got to say that in front of 196 countries. And as I was speaking, they had earpieces, and it was being translated in their language. And they got to hear. I know the Lord has given me strength to fight for my husband, but also he's given me a platform to share his gospel where the UN might have never had this straightforward message about the gospel. And you know, they were talking about peace and bringing world peace. And I got to share that this is the only way. And in the end of the message, I said, "And this is the God of peace you're all looking for." And so it's been amazing to the platform God has given me to fight for my husband, but also really to share the gospel, which is what this world needs. Mm. Our world is getting darker and darker.
Mm. Nagmeh, you are a brave woman, and we're standing with you in prayer, believing that Saeed is coming home sooner rather than later. And we thank you so much for that interview. And you can join the fight to free Saeed Abedini through your prayers, of course, and by signing a petition on the ACLJ website. You can find the link on our site, cbnnews.com. We'll be right back.
Hi, this is Pat Robertson. This is an important time in the history of America. It's an important time in the history of CBN. And what you do is so very important now. But we've got to get the gospel out here in America. We've got to help the poor and the needy, feed those who are hungry, clothe those who are naked, bring medical attention to those who are suffering, and more than anything, bring hope to those who are without hope throughout the world. So your 700 Club membership makes a huge difference. And I ask you to go to your phone and call. If you haven't already called in, we appreciate what you've done so much. So don't slack. We don't want our hands to be empty. We want to say, Lord, here are those who have come to you because of my labors. Telephones are available, toll-free line, and we just thank God for each one of you. So don't hesitate to call and do it now.
Jesus performed miracles that changed the world, and he shared the secret to that power with you and me.
Get Gordon Robertson's latest DVD, Our Father, Keys to the Lord's Prayer, and discover a deeper relationship with God, how to overcome evil, and realize the life-changing purpose God has for you.
Learn how to release the power of God's kingdom in your life.
Our Father, Keys to the Lord's Prayer, available now.
I just started surfing 5 years ago.
We actually said the Lord's Prayer when we got in the water the other day, and that's something I do.
I watched Our Father recently, and I loved it.
Gordon's teaching of the Lord's Prayer stood out. He's actually showing everybody, or he's teaching the steps to communicate with God. God wants us to be happy. He wants us to enjoy life. He's our Father, and he loves us.
Finally this week, God-fearing daredevil Nick Walenda took a historic high-wire walk across the Little Colorado River Gorge in Arizona near the Grand Canyon. He did it without a tether or a safety net, but he did take his faith in God out on that high wire. Here's George Thomas.
Praise you, Jesus.
It took Nick Walenda just 22 minutes to complete the daring walk across the Grand Canyon. The 34-year-old daredevil is a seventh-generation high-wire artist, part of the famous Flying Walenda circus family, a clan that is no stranger to death-defying feats. In the 1970s, his great-grandfather, Carl, fell to his death during a performance in Puerto Rico. Several other family members, including a cousin and an uncle, have perished while performing wire walking stunts. In an interview on the 700 Club, Walenda said he doesn't see his feats as that risky.
I don't see what I do as being more dangerous than a police officer. What I do is extremely calculated. I don't think God keeps me, holds me on the wire as I'm walking across, but God's given me a unique talent, and it's up to me whether I train properly for that.
As a devout Christian, he sees his talent and desire to perform as a gift from God.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's no question in my mind that God has laid these desires in my heart to carry on this family industry. I think that God has given me a very unique talent, and I can use that to bring glory to his name.
And he says he does it all for a higher purpose.
Thank you, Lord.
It's so important to me that every time before I do any of these big events, I get in a circle and pray with my family. And I always say, you know, give God the glory. Let God get the glory out of what I'm doing. That is very, very important to me, that people, they don't praise Nick Walenda, but they praise God for these amazing abilities. And I think that's part of showcasing like the Grand Canyon. To me, myself, it's hard to deny that there is a God when you see the Grand Canyon. That's my heart. And that's why I like to show these amazing places off around the world.
Wow, talk about a walk of faith. My heart is racing. I bet yours is too. Incredible. Well, that's going to do it for this edition of Christian World News. From all of us here, until next week, goodbye and God bless you.